Hello students, I welcome you to this class. So here we will study chapter 2 for students of class 9th. Second part of the chapter is the Shehnai of Bismillah Khan. Now, first of all, I would like to tell you about this person, Bismillah Khan. He was a very renowned Shehnai player in India. He is a legend. Why do I say he is a legend? Because he did something which has historical significance. He played the Shehnai on the day India got independence, that is 15th August 1947 at the Red Fort. Before the Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, gave his speech, before that, Bismillah Khan played the Shehnai in order to signify something auspicious. Something auspicious for the whole country was about to happen, that is, India was about to get freedom. And so, on that occasion, Bismillah Khan played the Shehnai. And that is why I say he is a legend. Now, let us begin with this chapter. First of all, before we read the story, do you know these people? Now, here you can see there are some people whose images have been given here. They are all musicians. They are all instrumentalists. They play different musical instruments. And then it says, what instruments do they play? So, you can search for them and you can come to know that they are very famous instrument players of India. And this is Bismillah Khan. He is playing the Shehnai. And this is the legend, Bismillah Khan, whose story we will read in this part. Now, one more thing it says, think of the Shehnai. And the first thing you will probably imagine is a wedding or a similar occasion or function. The next would probably be Ustad Bismillah Khan, the Shehnai maestro, playing this instrument. So, the writer of this chapter tells us that once you think of a Shehnai, Shehnai is played at wedding functions or any auspicious occasion. And so, whenever you think of the Shehnai, you are reminded of a wedding because probably most of us or many of us must have heard the Shehnai being played at a wedding function. And the next thing when you think about the Shehnai is Ustad Bismillah Khan. Because he was the maestro in Shehnai. He was a legendary Shehnai player. Now we will begin reading the chapter. Emperor Aurangzeb banned the playing of a musical instrument called Pungi in the royal residence for it had a shrill, unpleasant sound. Now Pungi was a predecessor of the Shehnai. Now when the Mughals ruled India, you know Mughals, they ruled India before the Britishers came to India. There was a very famous Mughal ruler, Aurangzeb. He banned. Banned means he prohibited. He did not allow that this musical instrument, Pungi, be played in his royal residence. Why did he ban this Pungi? Because it had a shrill, unpleasant sound. Shrill means very sharp. And unpleasant is something that you dislike. So, Aurangzeb banned the playing of the Pungi in his royal residence because the sound was not pleasant. He disliked the sound of the Pungi. Pungi became the generic name for reeded noisemakers. Generic name means a name given to a class or a group as a whole. Now, I'll give you an example of a medicine. What is the generic name? Generic name means the scientific name given to that particular salt. Like in medicine, we say paracetamol. That is the generic name. Now, paracetamol is sold by many brands. We get it under different names like Crocin, Calpol. So, these are the different names given to the same generic name, that is paracetamol. So, similarly, Pungi was a generic name. So any reeded noisemaker, reeded means wind instrument which have reeds like the flute, clarinet, etc. So any instrument which was made with a reed, like we have flutes, we have clarinets, they all were classified as Pungi. So pungi was a very broad term. Any type of an instrument which used wind to produce sound was termed as pungi. Few had thought that it would one day be revived. Revived means brought back to life. Now, as Aurangzeb had banned all these reeded noisemakers, he had banned pungis in his royal residence, no one thought that one day such noisemakers, such instruments which made unpleasant sound would be brought back into the trend. A barber of a family of professional musicians who had access to the royal palace decided to improve the tonal quality of the pungi. Tonal quality means the sound. Now, as the pungi had an unpleasant sound, there was a barber who belonged to a family of professional musicians. Now, he wanted to play the pungi, but he knew that the sound produced by the pungi was unpleasant, and so he decided to improve the sound. He chose a pipe with a natural hollow stem that was longer and broader than the pungi and made 7 holes on the body of the pipe. Now, what this barber did? He took a pipe which was a hollow stem. Hollow means it was empty from inside. And the pipe was longer and broader than the pungi. And then what he did? He made 7 holes on the body of that pipe. If you have seen a flute, it is something like this. It is a pipe which is hollow from inside and it has holes on it. When he played on it, closing and opening some of these holes, soft and melodious sounds were produced. Now, what this barber did, he prepared this pipe and he made 7 holes on it. Then he blew air in it and he closed and opened different holes of this pipe. And what he found out that soft and melodious sounds were produced when he did like this. He played the instrument before royalty and everyone was impressed. Now here you can see both these instruments have been given so you can make a comparison. This is a pungi and this is a shehnai. Shehnai is longer and broader than the stem of the pungi and there are holes on it. You blow air from this side and you close and open some of the holes and melodious and soft sound is produced. Now, when this barber played this instrument in the royal court, everyone was impressed. Everyone liked the sound produced by this instrument. The instrument, so different from the pungi, had to be given a new name. Now, the royal court thought that this instrument is different from the pungi and it should have a new name also. As the story goes, since it was first played in the Shah's chamber and was played by a Nai, that is barber, the instrument was named the Shehnai. Now there is a story behind the name given to this instrument and the story is that this instrument was played for the first time in the royal residence of the Shah. Shah was a name given to king. Mughals called the kings as Shah. And as the Nai, that is barber, had played this instrument for the first time, they called it Shehnai. So the first part is Sheh, which stands for Shah, and the second part Nai, that is it was played by a barber, that is Nai. So this instrument was named as Shehnai. The sound of the Shehnai began to be considered auspicious. Auspicious is something which promises to bring good fortune, which is auspicious, which is good fortunate, something which is a good omen. So the sound which was produced by a Shehnai was considered to be good, a good omen. And so it was played on good occasions. And for this reason, it is still played in the temples and is an indispensable component of any North Indian wedding. Indispensable means without which a piece of work cannot be done, something which is necessary. You can hear the Shehnai being played at many temples and at many weddings also. In the past, the Shehnai was part of the Naubat or traditional ensemble of 9 instruments found at royal courts. And ensemble means things considered as a group. So the Shehnai was considered to be part of the Nobat. Nobat is an Urdu word and it means traditional ensemble. That means a traditional group of 9 musical instruments. Now these 9 musical instruments were played at the royal court. And the Shehnai was also a part of this Nobat. Till recently, it was used only in temples and weddings. The credit for bringing this instrument onto the classical stage goes to Ustad Bismillah Khan. Now the Shehnai was played at the king's court, it was played in temples and weddings. But how did it reach the stage? That means people gave performances with the Shehnai. It was due to Ustad Bismillah Khan, who was a legendary Shehnai player, and people wanted to hear him play the Shehnai. As a 5-year-old, Bismillah Khan played Gilli Danda near a pond in the ancient estate of Dumraon in Bihar. Now from here, we start reading the story of Ustad Bismillah Khan. When he was 5 years old, he lived in the ancient, that means the old estate, and the name of the estate was Dumraon, and it is located in present day Bihar state. And when Bismillah Khan was 5-year-old, he used to play Gilli Danda. Gilli Danda is an old sport, quite similar to cricket you can say, but it's different from cricket in some ways. So this kind of a game he used to play when he was 5 years old. He would regularly go to the nearby Bihariji temple to sing the Bhojpuri Chaita, at the end of which he would earn a big laddu weighing 1.25 kg, a prize given by the local Maharaja. So when Bismillah Khanji was 5 years old, he would go to the nearby Bihariji temple. Although Bismillah Khan was a Muslim, he would go to the temple and he would sing this song in Bhojpuri language. Bhojpuri language is spoken in this area of Bihar. And this song was named as Chaita. And when he would finish reciting this song, he would get a big laddu as a reward, and the weight of that laddu was 1.25 kg. And this was a prize given to Bismillah Khan by the local Maharaja for singing this song. This happened 80 years ago and the little boy has travelled far to earn the highest civilian award in India, the Bharat Ratna. So the writer says that this incident, when he was 5 years old, he would get this laddu as a reward. And after 80 years, Bismillah Khan earned the highest civilian award of India, that is the Bharat Ratna. So this is the distance that he has travelled in his life. At 5 years of age, he would get a 1.25 kg laddu as a reward. He achieved the highest civilian award in India, that is the Bharat Ratna. Born on 21st March 1916, Bismillah belongs to a well-known family of musicians from Bihar. So Bismillah Khan was born on 21st March 1916 and he was born in a family of musicians in Bihar. His grandfather, Rasool Baksh Khan, was the Shehnai Nawaz of the Bhojpur King's Court. His father, Peygamber Baksh, and other paternal ancestors were also great Shehnai players. Paternal ancestors means ancestors of the father. So in the lineage of his father's side, all the people were great Shehnai players. So we can say that Bismillah Khanji acquired this skill of playing the Shehnai from his ancestors. His grandfather was a great Shehnai player. He played Shehnai in the court of the Bhojpur king. His father and all the paternal ancestors were also great Shehnai players. The young boy took to music early in life. So the young boy here means Bismillah Khanji. He also started learning music at an early age. At the age of 3, when his mother took him to his maternal uncle's house in Benares, now Varanasi, Bismillah was fascinated watching his uncles practice the Shehnai. So when Bismillah Khanji was just 3 years old, his mother took him to her parents' house, that is maternal uncles. Maternal uncles means the lineage on your mother's side. So they lived in Banaras. Banaras is today called Varanasi. And when Bismillah Khan saw his uncles, his maternal uncles, play the Shehnai, he was fascinated. That means he was attracted towards it and he also wanted to learn. Soon Bismillah started accompanying his uncle Ali Baksh to the Vishnu temple of Banaras, where Baksh was employed to play the Shehnai. So Bismillah Khan started going with his maternal uncle Ali Baksh to the Vishnu temple in Banaras. Ali Baksh was employed. He was on a duty to play the Shehnai at this Vishnu temple of Banaras. Ali Baksh would play the Shehnai and Bismillah would sit captivated for hours on end. Captivated means attracted. Now when Bismillah Khan saw his uncle Ali Baksh play the Shehnai, he was so attracted towards it, he was captivated and he would sit there for hours listening to him play the Shehnai. Now on end means for a very long time without stopping. That means continuously. So Bismillah Khan was a small child, but still he would sit there. He was so much attracted to the sound of the Shehnai that he would keep on sitting there continuously for a very long time, listening to his uncle play the Shehnai. Slowly he started getting lessons in playing the instrument and would sit practicing throughout the day. So gradually Bismillah Khan also started learning playing the Shehnai and he would practice throughout the day. So he never got tired. He was so captivated by this instrument, the Shehnai. For years to come, the temple of Balaji and Mangalaya Maiya and the banks of the Ganga became the young apprentice's favorite haunts where he could practice in solitude. Now, apprentice is a person who is taking training. A person who is under training is an apprentice. Haunt means a place where you like to come, where you like to frequent, where you like to visit many times a day. And solitude means being alone, being single. So for many years, Ustad Bismillah Khan remained in Banaras. He would visit the temple of Balaji, temple of Mangalmaya, and he would remain on the bank of river Ganga, where he would practice playing the Shehnai all alone. The flowing waters of the Ganga inspired him to improvise and invent ragas that were earlier considered to be beyond the range of the Shehnai. Now here we come to know the talent of Ustad Bismillah Khan. He was so inspired, that means the river Ganga motivated him, it provoked him to improve his performance, and he also invented many ragas that were earlier considered to be beyond the range of the Shehnai. So earlier it was considered that you cannot produce that kind of sound from the Shehnai, but Ustad Bismillah Khan went ahead. He practiced so much, he worked hard, and he invented different sounds with the Shehnai. At the age of 14, Bismillah accompanied his uncle to the Allahabad Music Conference. Now when Bismillah Khan was 14, he accompanied his maternal uncle Ali Baksh to the Allahabad Music Conference. At the end of his recital, recital means his performance, Ustad Payyas Khan patted the young boy's back and said, "Work hard and you shall make it." Ustad Payyas Khan liked his performance and he said that if he would work hard like this, he would make it. That means he would make a name in the field of music. With the opening of the All India Radio in Lucknow in 1938 came Bismillah's big break. Now when All India Radio, that is a radio station, was opened in Lucknow, Ustad Bismillah Khan got his first break, that is he started performing on this radio station. He soon became an often heard Shehnai player on radio. So his performance was on air on the All India Radio studio in Lucknow. When India gained independence on 15th August 1947, Bismillah Khan became the first Indian to greet the nation with his Shehnai. That is what I told you at the beginning of the chapter. Ustad Bismillah Khan is a legend because he was the first Indian to greet the entire nation through his shehnai. He played shehnai on this memorable occasion. He poured his heart out into Rag Kafi from the Red Fort to an audience which included Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who later gave his famous Tyrist with Destiny speech. So now we know which Rag was played by Ustad Bismillah Khan on the occasion of the independence of India, Rag Kafi. And he played it from the Red Fort. And after his performance, the first Prime Minister of India, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, gave his famous speech. And the name of the speech is Tyrist with Destiny. Bismillah Khan has given many memorable performances both in India and abroad. His first trip abroad was to Afghanistan, where King Zahir Shah was so taken in by the maestro that he gifted him priceless Persian carpets and other souvenirs. Taken in means attracted or charmed by. He was attracted. He really liked Ustad Bismillah Khan's performance. And souvenirs means things given in memory of a place, person or event. So, the King of Afghanistan, King Zahir Shah, really liked Bismillah Khan's performance. And he gifted him many things which were made in Afghanistan, like Persian carpets, etc., so that Ustad Bismillah Khan should remember his first visit abroad, that was to Afghanistan. The King of Afghanistan was not the only one to be fascinated with Bismillah's music. So, there are many other people also who were attracted to his shehnai's music. Film director Vijay Bhatt was so impressed after hearing Bismillah play at a festival that he named a film after the instrument called Goonj Uthi Shehnai. So, Goonj Uthi Shehnai is the name of a Hindi movie. This movie was made by Vijay Bhatt. He was a film director and he really liked the sound of the shehnai played by Bismillah Khan, and that is why he named his movie Goonj Uthi Shehnai. The film was a hit, and one of Bismillah Khan's compositions, Dil Ka Khilona Hai Toot Gaya, turned out to be a nationwide chartbuster. Chartbuster means record breaker. So, there was this song in this movie, Goonj Uthi Shehnai. The name of the song was Dil Ka Khilona Hai Toot Gaya. It was composed by Ustad Bismillah Khan. And this song was a chartbuster. It broke all records. Despite this huge success in the celluloid world, Bismillah Khan's ventures in film music were limited to two. Vijay Bhatt's Goonj Uthi Shehnai and Vikram Srinivas' Kannada venture, Sanadhi Appana. Now, celluloid is an old-fashioned way of referring to films, and venture means a project that often involves risk, something which has a lot of risk. So, although this song was a chartbuster, Bismillah Khan got a lot of success in this film, but still he just composed music for two films. The names of those movies are Goonj Uthi Shehnai, made by Vijay Bhatt, and there was a Kannada movie made by Vikram Srinivas, Sanadhi Appana. I just can't come to terms with the artificiality and glamour of the film world, he says with emphasis. Emphasis means to lay stress on something. Now, Ustad Bismillah Khan would say that he did not like the artificial world of films and the glamour that was there in the film world, and that is why he did not compose music for many movies. Awards and recognition came thick and fast. Thick and fast means he got a lot of awards and he was recognized at many places. Bismillah Khan became the first Indian to be invited to perform at the prestigious Lincoln Center Hall in the United States of America. He also took part in the World Exposition in Montreal, in the Cannes Art Festival and in the Osaka Trade Fair. So now we know where all Bismillah Khanji has performed all over the world. He has performed in United States of America at the Lincoln Center Hall. He has performed in Montreal, that is Australia, at the World Exposition. He has performed at the Cannes Art Festival. And he has also performed in Japan at the Osaka Trade Fair. So well known did he become internationally that an auditorium in Tehran was named after him, Tahar Musiki Ustad Bismillah Khan. Now Tehran is located in Iran. So Bismillah Khanji was so famous all over the world that in Tehran an auditorium has been named after Ustad Bismillah Khan. National awards like the Padma Shri, the Padma Bhushan and the Padma Vibhushan were conferred on him. Conferred means given to him, usually an award or a degree. When an award or a degree is given to someone, we say it has been conferred on him. So, Ustad Bismillah Khan has been awarded all these awards. In 2001, Ustad Bismillah Khan was awarded India's highest civilian award, the Bharat Ratna. With the coveted award resting on his chest and his eyes glinting with rare happiness, he said, "All I would like to say is, teach your children music. This is Hindustan's richest tradition. Even the West is now coming to learn our music." So when Ustad Bismillah Khanji received India's highest civilian award, the Bharat Ratna, in the year 2001, his eyes were glinting, that means shining. He was very happy because his hard work had been recognized. And he gave an important message to the country. He told all the Indians to teach music to their children because music is the richest tradition of India. And he said that even the Western countries wanted to learn India's music. In spite of having travelled all over the world, Khan Saab, as he is fondly called, is exceedingly fond of Benares and Dumrao, and they remain for him the most wonderful towns of the world. So although Ustad Bismillah Khanji had travelled all over the world, he was given so much of respect and recognition, but still, Benares, where he learnt music, and Dumrao, where he was born and brought up, were the two most wonderful towns of the world for him. So he was so grounded, he was so down to earth that although he had gone all over the world, still he was attached to his birthplace. A student of his once wanted him to head a Chennai school in the USA. And the student promised to recreate the atmosphere of Benares by replicating the temples there. Replicating means making a copy of something. So there was a student of Ustad Bismillah Khan and he wanted that Ustad Bismillah Khan should make a Chennai school in USA. And the student also promised that he would recreate the temples of Benares in America. But Khan Saab asked him if he would be able to transport River Ganga as well. Now, Ustad Bismillah Khan was attached to River Ganga also. So he asked his student that, okay, you will make these temples in America, but can you transport the River Ganga also to America? So he wanted to say that he can never leave India, he can never leave Benares because he is attached not only to the temples, but also to the River Ganga. Later he is remembered to have said, "That is why whenever I am in a foreign country, I keep yearning to see Hindustan." Yearning means longing, having a desire for something. So Ustad Bismillah Khan said that whenever he visits any foreign country, he is out of India, he is longing to see India. He wants to return to India. And then he says, "While in Mumbai, I think of only Benares and the holy Ganga." Then he says that when he is in India, when he is in Mumbai, he yearns, that means he wants to visit Benares and the Ganga River. And while in Benares, I miss the unique matha of Dumrao. And then he says when he is in Benares, he misses his birthplace Dumrao and the matha where he would sing the chaita and he was rewarded that laddu of 1.25 kg weight by the Maharaja. So here we come to know one very important thing, that is Ustad Bismillah Khan was very rooted. He was attached to his roots. That is why when he was in a foreign country, he missed India. When he was in Mumbai, he missed Benares. And when he was in Benares, he missed Dumrao. Ustad Bismillah Khan's life is a perfect example of the rich cultural heritage of India. One that effortlessly accepts that a devout Muslim like him can very naturally play the Shehnai every morning at the Kashi Vishwanath temple. Devote means believing strongly in a religion and obeying its laws and following its practices. So here the writer says that Ustad Bismillah Khan is a perfect example of the rich cultural heritage of India. That means his work was beyond the religion barriers. Although he was a strict Muslim, he followed the Mohammedan laws, but still, every morning he would play the Shehnai at the Kashi Vishwanath temple, which was a Hindu temple. This shows that he did not have the barriers of religion in his mind. So he was a true Indian. Ustad Bismillah Khan passed away on 21st August 2006 at the age of 90 after a prolonged illness. So Ustad Bismillah Khan had been ill for a long time and he died on 21st August 2006 at the age of 90. He was given a state funeral and the government of India declared one day of national mourning. So the entire country was grieving the death of a legendary musician. There was a holiday for one day and he was given a state funeral also. So with this, we have completed this chapter. Thank you.